I still don't understand what that Dr. Manley is saying. He's just confused. I don't know. I know that. Well, and see, they're not accurate anymore because a lot of people are doing the home tests and they don't call. No, and then plus most of the cases now are very mild, not all of them. And really, they told us to go by hospital beds and deaths, and that's extremely low right now. So that's the objective fact. Yeah, I mean, the deaths are still there, but they're tremendously down. Oh, yeah. There we are. What a big class today. This is a big day for our church, and I'm glad you're here. We'll start off with our Sunday school, and we always want to lift up our missionaries before Sunday school. On the back of your church bulletin, you'll see that our missionary of the week is John and Nikki Yingling, who are, of course, our own missionaries. John served two terms in American Samoa, and then he went out back to Bio Baptist International Outreach. He started off as missions director, general director, and then president of Bio. I heard Stephen Olford talk one time about the ministry of ministers to each other, and he said this. He said the ministry to ministers is ministry to the multitudes. When you're doing something like a missions director or a president of a Baptist International Outreach, your effect and your work is multiplied 100-fold. And for those of us who are not foreign missionaries that are giving and praying, our ministry will be multiplied when we get behind somebody like John and Nikki. Nikki's worked 13 years in the office. They are a dynamic couple. They're part of our Sunday school, part of our church, sent from here, and so they're very special people. So lift them up, John and Nikki Yingling. We'll go to Ruth chapter 4 today. We're going to be in the very last session of a short series called Redeeming Love. We studied the individual people in the book of Ruth. We studied Boaz and Elimelech and Naomi and all sorts of parts. And now Dr. Rogers, our amanuensis for this lesson, has put this all together. And the title of the lesson today is Redeeming Love. And it talks about a happy ending and what was a very dark story when we began. This little boy went into a pet store to buy a puppy, and his mother said, "Which one do you want?" And he pointed to the one that had the waggy tail. But he didn't say that. He said, "I want the one with the happy ending." Well, this is the happy ending for the book of Ruth. The book of Genesis starts with a garden and ends with a coffin. The book of Ruth begins with a funeral, ends with a wedding. It begins with famine that's driving people around by the sovereign hand of God or the sinful hand of man, but it ends with fullness. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning, especially when we've learned who and what Ruth represents. Two people get married in this story. I hope they lived happily forever after. Ruth and Boaz was a love story. We talked today, it would be a mini-series. The Maid from Moab and the Bachelor from Bethlehem got together and changed history. As you know, Ruth was in the line of the seed of the genetic line of the Lord Jesus Christ. She was, however, in her beginning, a Moabitess. She was a nobody from nowhere that a decent person wouldn't stand to be around. She was from a hated and cursed nation. She was excluded from the worship of God by the people of Israel and by the hand and the word of God himself. Yet Boaz chose to redeem her and brought her in and brought her out. And now Ruth is a picture of all of us unworthy yet wedded and welded to our heavenly bridegroom, the Lord Jesus Christ. Boaz is a picture, especially, and we've studied this, of the kinsman redeemer, somebody that could lay one hand on your situation but have the right, the authority, the power, and the will to make things right and to make a tremendous difference in this a cursed girl's life. She was the wrong kind of girl, just like you're the wrong kind of guy, and I am too. And because of Christ's love and the mercy he had for us and the rich mercy, we've been redeemed. That is the key word in Ruth chapter 4. 15 times a variation of the word redeem. In Ruth chapter 4, verse 4, it says, I thought to advertise, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people, if thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me, for there is none to redeem. So it's not a very far stretch to say that's the focus of this chapter. You recall the story, and we're going to notice three pictures in this chapter as we close out our study of the book of Ruth. In the Old Testament, you know, we study the Old Testament a lot, and the Bible says that the things that were written aforetime were written for our admonition and for our instruction. They are word pictures to show us great truths which will be fleshed out in the life of the church and the Lord Jesus Christ hundreds of years after that. But they are accurate pictures, and they're confirmations and affirmations of the inspiration of Scripture that they can teach us by that. None of the things we studied in the book of Ruth could happen by accident. None of them could happen by chance. In the three pictures today, number one, we'll study our redeeming Lord. He gets the glory for this. You and I did nothing but stink things up and sin. Number two, not only our redeeming Lord, but Moabitess's, Ruth's new life and our new life. Number three, not only a redeeming Lord and a renewed life, but our restored legacy. You mark this, we gain more in Christ than we ever lost in Adam. Same thing for Ruth. We get a great addition to our state before God, better than the innocency of Adam and Eve would have been if they had not sinned. We'll see that today. Number one, first point I want you to see is our redeeming Lord. Go to Ruth chapter 4, begin in verse 1. Then went Boaz up to the gate and sat him down there, and behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz spake came by, unto whom he said, ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here. And he turned aside and sat down, and he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, sit ye down here. And they sat down, and everything was getting decently in an order here. He said unto the kinsman, Naomi, that is, come again out of the country of Moab, selleth a parcel of land which was our brother Elimelech's. I thought to advertise thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of the people. If thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. If thou wilt not redeem it, tell me that I may know. For there is none to redeem it beside thee. I am after thee. And he said, I'll redeem it. Then Boaz said, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead unto his inheritance. And the kinsman said, nice girl, but it's expensive. He was a crusty old bachelor. There's a point at which men get beady-eyed about this thing about marriage. They think about it for a while, then they say, those women, they can be awfully expensive. I don't know. And their hearts get gnarled and cold like a lump of coal. That's what this guy was. He wanted that land. And he said, well, guess what? A wonderful girl comes with it, and you'll take on her care and raise up a seed to her people. He said, I don't think I will. I just don't think I will. Thank you, sir. And he got out of there as fast as he could. The kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. What a cold-blooded person. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. Here's the background on our redeeming Lord. In ancient Israel was that day, and we studied it for weeks, the law of the kinsman redeemer, and another law called a Levirate marriage. God would give the land to a tribe and a family, and he wanted that land to stay in that tribe and stay in that family. If bankruptcy occurred, if some death occurred, a close family member with the money and the heart to do so could buy that land back for the family, and thus the law of the kinsman redeemer. Further, there was a law of Levirate marriage. Someone died, no remaining children to bear the name and the testimony of the one that died. And the idea was that a brother of the dead man would come and take his place as far as marrying the man's widow and raising up children to the man that was gone. They were very family-centered. They were very tribe-centered, and God was very serious about this. These things you can read about in Leviticus 25 and Deuteronomy 25. Boaz, in this story, historically, was a kinsman redeemer. And he was going to marry Ruth, a widow whose husband had died and lost the estate. The three things were necessary for a man to function as a kinsman redeemer and to execute a levirate marriage. Number one, he had to have legal qualifications. He had to be a kinsman, a near kinsman, and someone that had an interest in this. Number two, not only the legal qualifications, he had to have the money to do it. You've got all sorts of good ideas, and you've got all sorts of plans. And if I ask you what you're going to do with your time or your future, you say, oh, if I only had that $1 million. If not, no, not the lottery, I know we're Baptist, but that publisher's clearinghouse sweepstakes, that $7,000 a week for the rest of our life, I've got the golf cart to head down to the mailbox and pick up the money every week, and I'd give so much to the church, and I'd do this and that, and everybody just goes, you don't give a nickel on $100. You know that this person's not going to do that. Number one, you had to have legal qualifications, but you had to have the money to buy back all this property and raise up all these children. That's not cheap. And number three, not only the legal qualifications and the financial qualifications, here's the big thing, you had to have a heart to do it. And that's a big jump for a man to take on that responsibility when he didn't have to, I mean, he wasn't forced to. This is a picture of the redeeming work of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ had righteousness to give, and he had no sin account on his table. He could take care of us. Were we worth it? No. Would I have done it for you? No. Would you have done it for me? No. But this is the Lord Jesus Christ. Ye the quickened which were dead in trespasses and sin. But God, who's rich in mercy, that's the idea. Boaz was rich in mercy and beautifully as a human pictures the Lord Jesus Christ, who was 1,000 times more rich in mercy than you and I would ever be. Do you see, number one, that Boaz, like Christ, is legally worthy? Look in verse 6 of Ruth chapter 4. And the kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. He is acknowledged by the people in the gate and even by the one who was unworthily turning this down as to be someone who could be and wanted to be a kinsman redeemer. Boaz says to Ruth, I'd be happy to marry you. I'd be happy to spend the rest of my life in you. He was in love with her. She was in love with him. He said, I will do it, and I will take whatever amount of money it takes. But there is another first in line, and he must have the offer first. Near a kinsman, come over here. He explains the whole thing and said, do you want the property? He said, I sure do. He liked that property. Now, along with the property comes a woman who was worth 1,000 times more than that property, and we still talk about today as being part, again, of that line of the seed that produced the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, do you want Ruth? He said, no, I think I've changed my mind. No, sir, thank you. Goodbye, goodbye. Who would this man be to us today? Dr. Rogers mentioned this would almost be like Adam. You say, do you want the Lord Jesus Christ? He said, no, I think I can be good. I'll be good enough, and I'll be okay, and I'll just follow the rules, and I'll be like Adam. Adam might be a nearer kinsman in that sense than the Lord Jesus to us. The Bible says all of us are either in Christ or we're in Adam. But wisely, they did not go to that. Boaz had called 10 witnesses. The law of God is a picture of that. We talked about this, and as we picture the Lord Jesus Christ in Ruth and Jesus in Boaz, that is. Romans 3:20 says nobody is saved by keeping the law. 10 friends are not. Romans 3:20 says, by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. If you come to my office and want to help with your heart problems, and I don't get much traction the first thing I try with you, I don't need a bigger stethoscope. I don't need to check the blood pressure 4 or 5 times more. Checking things doesn't make you better. That's not medicine. That's not healing. That's not helpful. Same thing here. We have sinned, and even if we were perfect for the rest of our life, God requires that which is past. It's going to be dealt with, and it can't be dealt with by being good forever. All of us have broken the Ten Commandments. All of us have broken the laws written on the heart in the Sermon on the Mount. adultery or murder, if you haven't committed it outwardly, I'm glad, but look upon a woman or a man with lust, God writes down adultery. You look upon your brother with hate, God writes down murder. We're in a sad, sad state. That chapter 4, verse 6, did you see those letters? I, me, my. Full of himself, cannot save, sinful and selfish. Guess who can save somebody like us who has fouled up the legacy of Adam, who has embraced every outward sin that we think we can get away with, and committed sins in our heart that are marked down in full view of God in open record in heaven. That's us. Why did the Son of God become the Son of Man? Why the virgin birth? Why the picture of somebody that would step in and help? Hebrews 2:16 says, verily, he took not upon him the nature of angels, but took he on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore, in all things, it behooveth him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. You know who we have? We have a mediator that is both God and man. He is our kinsman redeemer. He is able to redeem because he is sinless and he is mighty and he is wealthy as far as righteousness to give. And he's also like us. He is somebody just like us. There is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Boaz in the story was worthy. Jesus in our lives is absolutely worthy. That's the idea. Jesus Christ is legally worthy and able to redeem us as a man. Someone said our estate was legally lost. It needs to be righteously regained. Lost by our nearer kinsman, Adam, regained only by a willing near kinsman, Jesus. That's the idea. Look in, or Mark, write it down if you want, Revelation chapter 5. Verses 1 through 9, these are shouting verses. I'll try to keep it down here. I saw the hand of him that sat on the throne, a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals, a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and loose the seals thereof? No man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. One of the elders said unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and the four beasts, the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns, seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat on the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints, saying, and they sang a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book, to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. That's John on the Isle of Patmos with a vision of things to come. That book, you know, is the title deed to the entire earth, determining the outcome of all of human history. That lamb word there, we capitalize it sometimes, but it means a baby lamb. You should capitalize it, but understand it was a pathetic, killed, slain, weak person as far as the world was concerned. But he alone is worthy and has redeemeth. None willing, none worthy. John sees the lamb. He alone is able. This world's in a mess. I don't care whether you watch Fox News or CNN or MSNBC or whether you're on the right or the left. This world is a mess. And against all that the dragon and all that the beast can do, God, instead of bringing out a howitzer, brings out a lamb. And this is that little lamb alone is worthy to have wrought victory and redeemed us to God by his blood. Remember where we are in this outline. Jesus Christ, like Boaz in our picture story in the Old Testament, is legally worthy. The second point, thank goodness, Jesus Christ is lavishly wealthy. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, the silver in every mine. Elon Musk couldn't clean his car in the garage every other Saturday. These rich people of the earth are nothing compared to the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 18 says, "For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by the tradition of your fathers, but by the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without spot and without blemish." He's worthy there, and he is wealthy there. Ephesians 1:7, "In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace." Revelation 5:9, we just sang. Romans 5:8 is a picture of him being dealing with us in a different way. Romans 5:8 says, "God commendeth his love to us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Jesus Christ paid for much more for you and much more for me than Boaz paid for Ruth. And we don't have the proper words. We don't have the time, if we did have the proper words, to explain the cost of this redemption payment. We see what it cost in the story of Ruth, and you know what it cost in your life. The old songs and the old poets say that we were redeemed by the silver of his tears, by the gold of his blood. He was willing to redeem. Number one, he was legally worthy. Number two, he was lavishly wealthy. Number three, he was lovingly willing. Ladies and men, if you're married happily, I hope this was how the story of your romance. I hope somebody was a good, upright person. He was the right kind of person to be talking to you and dealing with you. Wouldn't hurt if he was lavishly wealthy. You're probably more spiritually than I am about that, but I've been looking for somebody like this to be part of our family my whole life. It hasn't happened. Uncle Fred never calls. The phone that rings is never him. And then if he did, he'd probably say, "Wrong number. Wrong number." But wouldn't you like if you heard a voice coming through the phone and said, I am going to help you. I've wanted to do this for years. I just love you and your family. I'm going to do it." When you have that combination, legally worthy, lavishly wealthy, lovingly willing, whether it's a future husband or wife or it's cousin Fred or Uncle John, that's a happy day. You're singing my song. This is wonderful. It's better than we deserve. He didn't have to redeem us. Boaz didn't have to redeem Ruth. He wanted to. His heart was big. If he just with a snarl said, "Well, I guess I got to," then we'd walk away from him. That's nothing. He wasn't like that. You don't know many people. Most nice people aren't wealthy, and most wealthy people aren't nice. It just things like this don't happen, to meet all of these things in one person. And this was the right person. He was under no compulsion. Nothing. We hear that sometimes about we were worth so much, and we appreciate God dying for us, but it was in spite of who we were. Not at all because, he just thought that we were so wonderful, and he's a wonderful, loving Lord. That's great. He is love. The outflow of that love magnifies his name and the nature in that we are intrinsically unlovable, yet he died for us. This is the Old Testament picture, again, of Romans 5:8, "God commendeth his love to us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Number one, our redeeming Lord. Magnify the Lord. Magnify his ability. Magnify his status. Magnify the riches of his grace. Magnify the loving heart that he has. You don't find people like that on this earth anymore. You never did. I mean, just might as well. Did you hear about those three women in Granger County? Oh, I can't help this. They were sitting there and they said, "Things aren't like they used to be." The second one said, "I don't think they ever were." And the third one said, "It's getting more and more like that every day." Well, you never had somebody like Christ, no matter how much you search human history or the Old Testament history or whatever. Number one, our redeeming Lord. Number two, back to us being pictured in Ruth. You may be a man with a beard or something, and you think, "Well, who am I?" In the picture of the Bible, you're part of the bride of Christ. Christ is the initiator. Christ is the one who comes out after you in love and brings you in. Think who Ruth was and what she was. Here is Ruth picturing us. Ruth had three main problems that were going to keep her from being in position to have anything to do with somebody like Boaz. In Ephesians 12, excuse me, Ephesians, there is no Ephesians 12. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, it says this: "But at that time ye were without Christ." This is Ruth not knowing the God of heaven, and she's learning about him very much there. You and I wasn't raised in a Christian home. I have no Christian background. God saved me in my mid-20s. "At that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ." All are either with or without Christ. Here is a description of all of us in our flesh, children of Adam's ruined race. We are outside of Christ. Ruth was outside a covenant relationship with the God of Israel and his people. Her problem was the same as yours: her past, her present, and her future. Other than that, she was fine. But she had a bad past. She wasn't any good now in the sight of God, and she didn't have much to look forward to. Every unsaved man, boy, girl, or woman has a problem with their past, a problem with their present, and a problem with their future. Her past was much worse even than perhaps yours is today, if you haven't come to Christ. She was a Moabite, a terrible tribe that was a product of incest, which is a terrible sin. So you couldn't get a worse family tree than this. And God felt the same way. He specifically proscribed them from worshiping or entering in or being part of the nation of Israel for generations and generations. Deuteronomy 23:3 says, "An Ammonite or a Moabite shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord. Even to their 10th generation shall they not enter into the congregation of the Lord forever." You move to a little town like this, and what if they put a notice out at the Baptist Association or in the paper or something like that, and said, "That bunch down there where the Manleys live are the lowest form of life, and we're not going to have them step foot in our church for 10 generations. If generation is 20 years, that's 200 years. They would probably turn their back on you at Lowe's and clap shoes together or something at Walmart, but you're just out. You were completely out. The Moabites were descendants of Lot from the incest he committed with his daughter and were a thorn in the side of Israel. By law, Ruth was shut out, and you're shut out too. God is of purer eyes than to behold sin. The Bible says he had to make him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Our righteousness was filthy rags and wickedness, and it was worth turning your back on. God would have nothing to do with people like you and people like me in our own self after what we had done. Spiritually, she and we were all born on the wrong side of the track. So number one, she needed a renewed life because her past was all scrambled up. You know, normally when a baby is born, it's a clean slate. I delivered babies for 4 years. I haven't delivered one in 30 years. Please find somebody else to deliver them. But I'll tell you one thing I never saw in the obstetrical department was a policeman or a judge with a warrant waiting for that baby. We've been looking for this baby, and we're taking him in. You know what? That baby is all future, no past. Unfortunately, that's not true at this level. She was born into a bad family, just like you and I. In a sense, we're born into a glorious family of Adam and Eve. In a sense, a wicked family of Adam and Eve, born on the wrong side of the tracks. And then also, not only her past and your past, but her present and your present. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12 again, said that she was without Christ, aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Strangers from the covenant of God, not associated in our case with new life in Christ. Outside, dead, best works, a stench in the nostrils of God, bad, bad shape. Dreams turned to dust, hopes melted away. That for her and for us, outside the covenant people of God in the Old Testament, outside the person of the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament. Her bad past, your bad past. Her bad present, your bad present. Her future, having no hope. Her past was dismal, her present was crushed, her future is condemned. God needs to help people understand where they are. We are all in bad shape. We are not candidates for fellowshipping with somebody like God. We are absolutely the antithetical to who and what God is. Coming to church won't fix that. Sitting won't fix that. You have to undergo a great exchange whereby you, being wicked, are treated as though you are righteous because of the alien foreign righteousness of another, the Lord Jesus Christ, who's placed on your account. And he, being sinless, is treated as though he was wicked, bearing your filthiness and your sin on his back. It is a complete exchange of a debit and credit on the accounting ledgers of heaven. And it is not something that you could carry out or make happen. You want to talk about that, God's righteousness and that of Jesus Christ. We are happy it didn't end here for Ruth, and it didn't end here for you and me. In Ephesians 2:19, it says, "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners." It's the exact reverse of what we read in the Old Testament. "And fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God." Who has opened this new way? Who has broken down these barriers? Boaz in the Old Testament redeemed her. By marrying into his family, she had the curse lifted. Her poverty was now reversed. That ching sound you hear, that beep on your phone, is a deposit going into your online account from somebody that is giving it to you that you didn't deserve it. And there's enough zeros after it, your troubles are over. And that's just a faint picture of the righteousness that's being placed in our account. Redemption is to ransom for a price, bought out of the marketplace, set free in the Savior. That's what happened to Ruth, a tremendous paradigm shift of who she was in relation to God and the people around her. Same way for you and me. The illustration to make that clear. Remember, we went back to Ruth. They said, "Now you're the nearest kinsman," the old beady-eyed guy that didn't turn out well. He said, "Well, and you can have a chance to get in on this, the property, and to doing the right thing for poor Elimelech. And here is Ruth, and you can marry her. It'd be great." He said, "I won't buy her back. I can't buy her back. I don't want to mar my own inheritance." Ruth 4:7 says, "Now this was the manner in the former time in Israel concerning redeeming and concerning changing. For to confirm all things, a man plucked off his shoe, gave it to his neighbor, and this was a testimony in Israel. Therefore the kinsman said unto Boaz, buy it for thee. Go ahead." And I just know Boaz played this just right. He went, "Oh, okay, I guess I will. Yes. I've got my family put together. This beautiful girl," you can tell throughout the entire story of Ruth, he was just like, he was totally overwhelmed with Ruth. It is a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful story. One person took the place of another person. One was willing when the other would just look down their nose. And you and I are not like Christ. There's all sorts of people that may be in bad shape, and they could say, "You know, maybe you could just take over care of their home and their family and send all their grandkids to 4 years of college." You go, "I don't think I can do that." Not very many people could. Christ could. Boaz could. Boaz was a mighty man, a wealthy man, the kind of man we want on our side. That's the idea. He stands in our shoes, Jesus does, just like Boaz, literally. When he saves us, he pays the price we can't pay, assumes the responsibility for the whole thing. The whole thing. Again, my favorite verse, 2 Corinthians 5:21. "He hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." There's that great exchange. There is someone who is wicked being treated as righteous, and someone who is absolutely righteous for our sake being treated as though he was absolutely wicked. This is an alien woman with no past, a bad present, and a terrible future. Boaz said something that you and I wouldn't have said. He said, "I'll take this matter in hand, I'll straighten this out, and I will bless this woman." Overwhelmingly, and again, remember, whether you're male or female in here, you are pictured in Ruth as you are in the bride of Christ. Number three, not only our renewed life, but our restored legacy. Well, I guess you can come in the family, but you can sit in the back room and be quiet. No. No, it's none of that third-class citizen stuff. Watch what Ruth got back. And again, remember what I said at the beginning of the lesson. We get more in Christ through salvation and redemption than ever we lost in Adam. We are in better shape and with God as a redeemed person in Christ with the righteousness of Christ put on our account than if we had maintained innocency in the garden with Adam and Eve. Number one, Ruth got back five wonderful things. The first thing she got back was a family. Verse 10, moreover, Ruth, the Moabitess, the wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren and from the gate of his place. Ye are witnesses this day. She got a family. You know what? I have a nice family. It's a tiny family, and it's split right in the middle. Exactly half are saved and half aren't. My mother is saved. I've asked you for 30 years to pray for my dad, and I appreciate it very much if you would. He's 85. He's not saved. I don't come from a big family. One of the best things about coming to Christ when Christ called me and brought me to himself in 1985 was all of a sudden I had hundreds of people, just men, for example, that said, hello, Brother Emmett. You know what? They meant it. And that may not mean anything to you. You may have been raised out in the woods here in East Tennessee with 12 or 13 brothers, and you were tired of looking at them. I have one sister. I love my sister. She has no children. We have the two and the two grandchildren, but there's no big family. It matters to have a new family. It's wonderful to have a new family. And Ruth, who was an outcast, and everybody looked down at her and just, raising their nose up. That's for her to have people, and she had an honored position in that family. Number one, a family. Number two, a fortune. Again, verse 10, I have purchased to be my wife and raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. That's a lot of money. It needs to be handled wisely. Boaz is a mighty man of wealth. Mark this. He marries Ruth, and now all that he has is hers. To go from a charity case gleaning barley in a field to now, yes, ma'am, can I help you? Yes, I'd like this and that. Would you like me to wrap it up for you? Yes, just charge it to Boaz. That has a nice feeling. You walk out. That's wonderful. That is absolutely. And Boaz goes, he's not fussy like some men are. He said, whatever you want. Absolutely. We're going to. And then you think, this is the right kind of guy. Absolutely the right kind of guy. And you know what? We are, as hard as it is to believe, that's a big thing to go from a Moabite to charge it to Boaz. We are heirs of Christ, God, and joint heirs with Christ. That's just too much. You can't even imagine that. But it's true, and that not for silly things, we don't mean by that, but all that is needed for life and godliness. They'll say, can you need this? I say, I desperately need that. Well, Boaz left a message. He said to give it to you and charge it to him. How's that? Christ said the same thing. Number one, a family. Number two, a fortune. Number three, fame. You know, you don't want to, just not being selfish or prideful, to like for people to know who you are and to know you're a good person and to just be part of the community and the family. Look in verse 11. All the people that were in the gate and the elders said, we are witnesses. They did it right with the shoe and with the 10 witnesses. Every time I've had a will sign, the lawyer will always say, go out and see if Betty's out there and get Billy out of the back of the place. We need a couple of witnesses, and they have to write their name down, right? Well, this is 10. We are witnesses. The Lord make the woman that has come into thy house like Rachel and like Leah, which too did build the house of Israel, and do thou worthily in Ephrata and be famous in Bethlehem. They are saying, God bless you. You're not an outcast. You're not primarily a woman from a bad family and a bad country and a bad name. You are, in our prayers, going to be like the top women in Israel, like Rachel and like Leah, and to build the house of Israel. And she did. She built it under the line of the family, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the idea. Her name is now beautiful and well-known, and world over, people are preaching and teaching about this today. If we don't have Jesus in the New Testament, our bodies will rot in the grave and our souls will be in hell and we'll be the most miserable person in the world. And that would be just a faint picture, or Ruth's idea would be a faint picture of that. But she was a rejected and an outcast. But if you know Jesus and she knows Boaz, then you shine like the brightness of the stars forever and ever. In the story, the key thing of the whole story is, are you rightly related to Boaz, the provision that God has made for you? And the key thing in our life, in our story, is, are you rightly related to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the satisfaction for your sins, and is that rich relative who deals not in trinkets, but in all things that pertain to life and godliness? That's the idea. And to give you a new life. You see, in Christ, the coming to Christ is a legal transaction, but it's a life transformation. A legal transaction is the 2 Corinthians 5:21 great exchange. It's all through Isaiah about that great exchange. But the life transformation is four verses sooner, 2 Corinthians 5:17. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. So right there in four verses, you have got a universe shaking shift in who you are and who you're related to and what resources are available to you. This is a wonderful, wonderful picture. In Christ, you went from being a nobody to a royal blue blood. That is wonderful. Number four. Not only a new family, a new fortune, a new fame, new fruitfulness. Look in verse 12. And let thy house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bare unto Judah. There's another woman who is in a bad situation who got to be eventually in the line of the seed. And who Tamar bare unto Judah of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman. They are prophetically seeing that there is going to be some special people come out of this union, even more than maintaining the family name. That's why they started into this, but there is going to be a light that's going to come out of this and a wonderful person on down to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the idea. Fruitful. Jesus said, you've not chosen me, I have chosen you to bear fruit. And in that day and that time, that was to bring forth children and to raise them up and to have a wonderful family. Number five, a future. Look in Ruth 4:16. Naomi took the child and laid it on her bosom, became nurse to it. Here's when this happened. And the women, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, there is a son born to Naomi. They called his name Obed, for he is the father of Jesse, the father of David. There is the line which points not only to David, but great David's greater son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the idea. On down to Christ himself. And you know where Ruth is now? She's in heaven, serving the Lord. Past was an alien, present was a stranger, future without hope, but there was Boaz. Just like in Ephesians 2. You know the best verse in Ephesians 2? But all of a sudden things are going bad. He redeems who were wicked, but God, who is rich in mercy. That is the key verse in that. There was somebody here that reversed her alien past, her present as a stranger, her future without hope. There was a Boaz, and there was a Jesus, and they both are kinsman redeemer, Jesus with a capital K, lavishly wealthy, legally worthy, lovingly willing. And he wants to marry you and us and produce in us a family, a fortune, a fame, and a future. And even better than the Old Testament story, Jesus wants to give his life to redeem you and to overwhelmingly bless you. And you recall these witnesses. You know what the amazing thing was? Ruth thought, well, maybe this will be a little marriage on the side, and he'll be very kind, and it's to help me. Did you like C.S. Lewis' book? C.S. Lewis was married late in his life, and he did it because the woman had terminal cancer, and she was a friend of his, and she was going to be deported back to the United States, and she didn't want to leave her children. He said, let's just go down to the courthouse and get a legal marriage. We will not be married. You won't live with me. I won't live with you. Later on, he fell in love with her, and he did But maybe she thought this was going to be kind of like, well, thank you for your kindness, and here's a receipt for some land. No, Ruth and Boaz, just like us in Jesus, I want to give my life to redeem you. I want to overwhelmingly bless you. This episode in Ruth 4, he was not ashamed. He had all the witnesses, everybody in town. He said, this is my girl right here. I love her with all my heart. If any of you don't, you can come deal with me, and I wouldn't recommend it. That thrilled her. Not ashamed of him, he wasn't ashamed of her. Proud of him, he was proud of her, wanting everyone to know that this was his new wife. And she said, guess what? This is my new husband. She wasn't ashamed. She was a million miles away from it, wanting everyone to know every day. And that made her the happiest day of her life when he ratified all this and bought out her past and corrected her present and inscripturated her a wonderful future. She wasn't ashamed of Boaz before a wicked bunch of beady-eyed people in the days of the Old Testament. And you shouldn't be ashamed of Jesus Christ in a wicked, dark, every day the news gets worse generation. That's the idea. Well, we're through with Ruth. We'll start next week on Sunday school. Back, we're doing our All the People of the Bible series. And remember, we put a little pause here. But we'll go back to Saul/Paul next week. Well, I don't even know if I saw it was Saul. I don't know if it's the New Testament or the Old Testament. I haven't got to study on it yet. But we'll go back to our characters of the Bible. And that's a good series, too. Father, thanks for this special day in our church. And thank you for the gifts you've given us, especially Pastor Mark and Sister Terry. And thank you for our church and how it's just rejoicing today. And thank you for the wonderful things you do through Christ to the people today, just like you did through God and through Boaz and through these picture stories in the Old Testament. Thank you for these truths and burning them into our heart. Amen.